What do you enjoy most about the characters that you portray? Be honest. Go ahead, AJ.
Well, specifically for my character, it's such an interesting dynamic every night because people are not expecting me to walk out as Elder Cunningham.
Why is that?
Well, historically, my part was started by Josh Gad and by Jared Gertner, who you saw up there, someone a little shorter and stockier and maybe curly hair and just weird looking. And I'm obviously...
You were so not typecast.
Yeah, I'm just strikingly handsome.
You walked in with the six pack showing.
Yes, every night, and people. This confuses people a lot. I understand. But it is very interesting, you know, because I walk out, and you can feel the audience go, "That's not the guy from Frozen." We're not sure about him, and then so I sort of get to win them over every night, you know, and so I really like that dynamic, and the character itself, I just love. He's so positive, and he's always looking for the best in people, and he's such a socially awkward fanboy, you know. I knew people like this in high school, not myself, of course, but others, you know, who just had trouble, perhaps my friends interacting. Interacting with their social groups and forging connections in that way, and so it's a really familiar thing, and I think a lot of people can identify with.
That's great. And how about you?
Not me, but other.
Yeah, I think what's fun, you know, Elder Price is just so narcissistic and confident, and there's something so fun about just being able to do that. You know, I think, you know, everybody wants to have that champion moment in their life, and Elder Price lives his life like that all the time.
Tell us, for those of us that are not familiar with the show, tell us a little bit about Elder Price.
Sure. Elder Price is, you know, the Mormon team captain, if you will. I mean, he is like the guy. Mm-hmm. All of his friends in the Mormon missionary look to him, and he's going to be the guy who's going to graduate from, you know, their training program and just change the world. And so that's how he approaches the beginning of the show. And of course, you know, it does not go that way even a little bit. But there's something so fun about being able to have that sort of confidence on a day-to-day basis, that even if it's not something that's echoing in my real life, to just take 2 hours of my life and at least start the show that way, in this place of just like, yeah, it feels great. But then to also, you know, like I said before, the show just goes so terribly awry that to start the, and for the audience to feel that that's where I'm at, and then to play something that's so against my archetype, because, you know, for all you Wicked fans, I played Fiera, which is sort of like, he's like that all the time through the whole show, and there's not really anything too redeeming about that, but right. What's great about Elder Price is that he is so confident, and then he falls so far. And that, for my archetype, that it's so nice to play something that's gets to be so honest
and vulnerable,
because right. That's not something I really get to do all that much. And the show, it does right. It so well.
Yeah, because you walk around so gorgeous all the time. It must be tough.
It's, yeah.
Must be tough.
It's tough to do interviews with you too, I gotta tell you. Because I just, every time I dress, I put on a nicer shirt, and I leave, and Billy's put on an even nicer shirt.
You should know this, like a little behind the scenes. Every time we do an interview, I gauge what he's wearing, and then I dress nicer. So every time we've had an interview, he dresses a little nicer, and
it's
then I continue
enough.
To dress nicer.
It's like he's my mother, I'm never enough for you. It's awful.
Do you give the call the night before, what are you wearing?
Yeah.
You know, I think I know, because I was with him when he bought this whole outfit.
Actually, we sleep in the same room, so we're here.
So, AJ, tell us, for those of us that have not seen the show, tell us some about your character.
Elder Cunningham is a socially awkward fanboy, loves Star Wars, loves Star Trek, loves the fandom worlds of all sorts, and he sort of integrates them into his real life. You know, these imaginary characters and people are just as real to him as the people who surround him, because he doesn't really have friends of his own to connect with. So that's where he finds his reality. And I think where he differs from Elder Price and why he succeeds in Africa where Elder Price fails is, spoiler alert, he listens. You know, he actually listens to people and sees what their life is actually like. So though he starts, you know, making things up and kind of inventing this whole new religion for the African people that's based entirely on nonsense, it actually manages to connect with these people because he ties it in with their lives and their situations, their experience, and what they're going through. So I think though he comes across, you know, his energy is very abrasive and very hard to get a handle on and very hard to interact with at first, he really connects to something real.
Yeah. And do you find some of those traits about yourself? Or is he totally different from you?
No, I don't know what you're talking about. I don't like where this is going.
Okay, so you guys have been on tour. You're mm-hmm. in the first national tour, is that correct?
Correct.
How long have you been on tour?
Since February. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But I started on the other national tour of this show back in May of 2013.
So how long have you been doing the show now?
Going on 3 years, 2.5 years.
Wow, yeah. Fantastic.
Right when I get here will be the 3 year mark when we come to Hawaii.
And you get to celebrate in Hawaii.
Exactly.
What a way to go.
What a way to go, right? Can't
oh
wait.
Oh my gosh.
Can't believe we're here right now, by the way. This is incredible for us. We're so excited.
We're gonna talk faster so they can get outside into the sun. And how about you, Billy? How long have you been doing the tour?
We joined the tour together in February, but before that we were in London in the West End for 6 months there.
Wow. Can you tell us some of the cities that you've performed in doing this show?
Yeah, sure. We started after London, we went to Dallas. And
Kansas City,
Madison. We went to Canada a bunch, Edmonton, Calgary, Winnipeg, Vancouver. We did San Francisco for 11 weeks. That was very, very
wow.
cool. Denver was big.
Denver, Fresno, Albuquerque.
Right now we're in Las Vegas. Well, not right now, but you know.
Everyone else's.
Yes, yeah. We're supposed to be. We're playing hooky. They're very mad at us.
Did you have to tell your cast members that you were coming here?
They found out.
Yeah, I mean, we tried not to
brag.
But
are they
when
still
we're disappearing
here?
At the same time, it's like, where are you going? We're like, oh, we're going to talk Lord. About Mormon. Where? Hawaii.
Yeah.
Get up.
So they slammed the door behind you,
basically,
didn't they?
Yeah.
Gosh.
We're not allowed back.
So you both performed your roles in London's West End, which we all agree is just an incredible place to
Absolutely.
Be. You kind of have to like beer in order to spend any time in London.
Oh, boy.
There's a whole culture there we were discussing that.
Mm-hmm. Pub culture.
Yes, the pub culture. Now, is there a difference between the way that the audiences in the UK has responded to Book of Mormon as opposed to the way that the audiences in the U.S. has? Either of you.
Absolutely.
Really?
I think that's what's been so fascinating for us is to do this show. You know, now we just rattled off a bunch of cities which go from east to west and as well as the U.K. And it's been so different everywhere we go. And, I mean, it's different on a nightly basis, but every city has been drastically different. But London especially, I think then performing for an American audience was very interesting because I found that they were listening so much more intently than the typical American audience does, which makes it hard for comedy because they're really waiting on every word. So if you're going to get the laugh, you have to get it honestly, and you can't cheat it.
Right.
I guess it doesn't speak poorly of Americans, but.
Because we don't do that.
We all grew up watching like sitcoms, and I feel like a lot of times an American audience can respond to rhythms mm-hmm. that work in a sitcom, and you can sort of lead them into a laugh without them being like, "What? Wait, why are we laughing?"
Yeah. There's just a right. rhythm and a gesture to it. That this is the moment for a laugh, you know?
Laugh, yeah. And then they go, "Ah." London, you go laugh, and they're like,
"Yes."
That was.
What
was
Prove
funny,
it
though.
To me.
Yeah.
Yes.
Which is great, and especially for, you know, for me, it was the first place where I started playing Elder Price and doing the show and working on this relationship together. So I think for us, our relationship in the show and creating what we have together had to be really honest. And that's the way I think any actor really wants to work. Mm-hmm. And so I felt like it was an excellent training ground for this show, for us to really get our show together solidly.
Yeah.
And in the right place.
So you just really feel like you had to dig in. You couldn't cheat it
right.
at all. You don't cheat it now, right?
Never.
Because you would never do that,
we
right?
would never do that.
Ever.
You're bringing our A game.
No. That's it. We love that.
Well,
okay.
Well, every other night until we get here, we're sort of honestly phoning it in.